And the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Gentlemen, thank you both for being here this week. So the killing of the al-Qaeda operative Anwar al-Awlaki. David, we heard a minute ago about the national security implications. Does this have political implications for President Obama? Does it help him?
It probably doesn't help him. I think he deserves some recognition. I think the administration has pursued this quite vigorously. There's a lot of talk from Dick Cheney that it was September 10th mindset. Remember all that? But they clearly have a September 11th mindset, if you want to put that. They've pursued this very vigorously. And in some ways, the use of drones, they've probably been more assertive or more aggressive than the Bush administration. But they'll probably politically get relatively little benefit. It means that Republicans will not be attacking the Obama administration as weak, or at least I don't think that argument will have much purchase. But it won't be as if the country will say he's a really strong commander in chief. I think the issue will be neutralized. It won't redound to his benefit.
You agree?
I think, Julie, that voters already give him much higher marks as commander in chief than they do on his domestic leadership or his handling of the economy. So there is a recognition on the part of the voters how effective he has been, essentially, in his administration in dismantling al-Qaeda. And all but crippling that institution. The Republicans have had an historical advantage on the issue of national security, and I think it's fair to say that Barack Obama has gone a long way toward neutralizing that for the 2012 campaign. I agree with David that will not be some card that the Republicans will play. At the same time, when the economy is bad, the economy is the only issue. And that is the problem. I mean, that's going to be dominant. The elimination of al-Qaeda doesn't lead to jobs.
So they got bin Laden. They've now got al-Awlaki. They've gotten other al-Qaeda leaders. The president administration instrumental, David, in knocking off or removing, I should say, these dictators in Egypt and now Libya. Is there anything they could do internationally that?
Well, I mean, I would say a couple of things. First, the Arab Spring happened more or less on its own. I think that was a result of these deep fundamental courses that were set off by the democracy debate. The getting of Zarqawi, the getting of bin Laden took real courage from the president. So I give him a lot of credit on that individual decision. But basically, we now have set in place, we have a lot of criticism about the institutions of our government, but we have set in place a national security apparatus that takes al-Qaeda extremely seriously, and I would say goes after them quite effectively. And al-Qaeda has been severely, severely dismantled over the past 10 years, and that's something that will probably survive whatever party takes over. That institution, the national security apparatus, I think is pretty effective, set up 5-10 years ago, but now continuing quite effectively.
Well, I mean, he got a lift out of Osama bin Laden, but it was ephemeral.
It didn't last.
It does come back to all politics is local, and this is local, and local is the economy.
Another issue that may be before the voters next year, health care reform. The Justice Department, Mark, just asked the Supreme Court, in essence, to take a look at the law, whether it's constitutional. Could that have an effect on the campaign next year?
It could. In all likelihood, at least the judgment is that the decision will come down in June. And there's one of two options. The Supreme Court will say it's unconstitutional and therefore dismantle what was the signature legislative achievement of the administration, the primary effort made, or say that it is constitutional, and it will be a continuing issue in the campaign of 2012, Republicans saying that they want to repeal it, and the president and Democrats arguing that no, it's effective, and you can feel it already, and children are covered, and grown children are covered, and a pre-existing condition is a positive. But the most sticking point on it is what the Supreme Court's going to address, and that's the individual mandate.
And you think it could be a factor?
Yeah, I don't think the decision itself will be a factor. I think health care has been a significant factor. What happened in 2009, because of health care, a lot of independents moved away from President Obama for two reasons. One, they thought he was out of touch with their concerns because he was focusing on health care when they cared about jobs. And two, they thought he was more, he liked government more than they did. And since that happened in 2009, the electorate really hasn't changed. Those independents are still not thrilled with the Republicans, but not thrilled with Obama. And whether the Supreme Court overturns or doesn't the individual mandate, they still have taken health care as an informant toward their view of Obama, and it's generally not good news for the president.
All right, let's talk about the Republicans. A renewed pressure, a lot of pressure apparently, on New Jersey's governor, Chris Christie, to change his mind, get into the race. Mark, what do you hear? Who's behind this? Do you think he'll do it? What do you think?
Well, the reality is a lot of people spontaneously are behind it. I mean, there are strong financial support, a lot of New York money that would like to have him in, but that's not enough in itself. I mean, there's a genuine yearning out there. The Republicans have gone through a period. They had Donald Trump. He was a flavor. They had Michelle Bachmann. They had Rick Perry. Now it's Herman Cain. And they're looking for somebody. They've got Mitt Romney, and it seems to be Mitt Romney is like your wise sort of spinster aunt telling the young lady that he's a good provider. He's got good habits. He doesn't smoke. He doesn't drink. He keeps regular hours. He's a nice person. He's mannerly. Why don't you get excited? And they say, I want to be excited. You know, the young lady says, I really want somebody that I'm emotionally engaged with. And
Mrs. Romney might.
Well, that's right. But I think Chris Christie, you know, does excite people. There's what is most, I think, appealing about him is that he is the anti-politician. I mean, he doesn't talk like politicians. He doesn't say, that said. He doesn't say, not unimportant, or on the contrary, notwithstanding. He says, get the hell off the beach during a hurricane to people, and everybody can identify with that. And there is something direct. He is made for town meetings. He really is, with voters. So I think there's an appeal, whether in fact it's he's going to do it. He said time and again he's not going to.
Do you think he'll get in, and what effect would he have if he did?
Yeah, I mean, as Mark says, he has this phenomenal, rare skill of talking about wonky issues in a normal way. Mm-hmm. And that is just not something that comes along every day. And so he has that skill. But to follow Mark's metaphor, I agree the Republican primary electorate wants the guy with the leather jacket. But I think the country wants the guy from the Rotary Club. I think they want the Mitt Romney guy. Because we are in a very scary period. I expect before the election there's going to be more bad news from Europe or somewhere else. And my presumption is on elections, people always vote for the candidate who seems safer and more orderly. Obama seemed more orderly than McCain after the financial meltdown. Bush seemed more orderly. Whether they're really going to want somebody like Chris Christie, who's rambunctious and big and not exactly orderly, I'm not convinced. I think the Republicans should be pretty happy with Romney. He's become a very good campaigner, and he seems pretty safe and orderly, which I think is probably what the country's going to want.
So you're saying these voters right now who may be excited about Chris Christie or Herman Cain, which is, as Mark said, he's gotten a little attention. He won the Florida straw poll last week. That they'll eventually gravitate.
Well, I'm saying they should. I mean, the perception is that Obama moved the country sharply to the left, and they want somebody who'll shake things up and move it just as sharply to the right. And Romney doesn't send off those "I'm going to move the country in a radically disruptive direction" the way Trump does, the way the Herman Cain does, the way Chris Christie might.
Herminator. That's right. Herminator. I mean, it takes a Herminator to think that Obama's moved the country radically to the left.
I'm just describing.
I know you are. But
this does say something about, at least right now, the satisfaction with the rest of the Republican field.
Well, according to polls, the satisfaction is measured up, but there's just not an emotional connection. I mean, Mitt Romney may be a logical choice, but he's not one that says, boy, oh boy. I mean, you know, the difference at the time when Cicero spoke, people said how well he spoke, and when Demosthenes spoke, they said, let us march. I mean, nobody feels like marching after hearing.
And people do march after
hearing Chris Christie.
All right, the primary calendar. Normally we don't talk about this, but the Florida Republicans decided today that they're moving their vote up to January 31st, and so we assume that means that Iowa, New Hampshire, Nevada, South Carolina are all going to move up early. What effect, David, does this have on the contest?
A lot of us are going to spend New Year's Eve in Des Moines. That's what the effect it's going to have. It will force them to move up. I think the outside effect is you get a state, Florida, which has a minority population, which Iowa and New Hampshire don't exactly, and South Carolina and even Nevada don't have in the Republican side. And so I think it gives a little more say to maybe a Latino vote or something like that. But, going back historically, can you think of a time when the scheduling of the primaries had an effect on the outcome. I can't think of that time. So it's inconvenient for those of us who want to be home New Year's Eve rather than Des Moines, but I can't think of a time where it really affects the race.
You don't think it benefits?
I can't think of times, because I'm older than David, but certainly 1968 it did. Eugene McCarthy challenging Lyndon Johnson. 1984 it did. With Gary Hart and emerging.
The timing of the primaries?
The timing of the primary. I mean, the importance of, to me, of the first two primaries being Iowa and New Hampshire is paramount. The only chance that an underdog, underfinanced candidate has is to compensate for that candidate's lack of name recognition and money by spending time. John McCain could beat George Bush in New Hampshire in 2000, even though he was outspent by some estimates 6-1, even though he had the establishment of the party against him by 114 town meetings.
Right.
104. So in a small state, he actually could meet a critical number of voters and persuade them and make a difference. That requires time. When you compress this, like Florida's doing by moving up to 31st, it shortens the time. It hurts the underdog, underfinanced candidate. It helps the candidate who's ahead and who's got deep pockets. And the Republican National Committee showed themselves to be toothless tigers. They gave the
because
2012 convention.
Because they had said there would be a punishment.
A real punishment. Going to cost you half the delegates, all of whom will be seated right. when the convention opens up right. in Tampa. I mean, it's absolutely outrageous. And it really changes the whole dynamic, to me, of the
Yeah, I don't think so. First, I'm not a big believer there's momentum. Remember, Barack Obama ran out of Iowa with all this momentum, and Hillary Clinton turned around, did pretty well in New Hampshire. And the second thing, we're not going to lose those first two states. I don't care if they have to schedule their caucuses and primaries in September. They're not going to not be first. They will be first. And in the Republican side, Iowa doesn't matter that much. They're so conservative, they pick outliers. New Hampshire matters a lot. And so there will be that New Hampshire primary, but then they'll go on to Florida, South Carolina, Nevada.
There's a vetting that goes on. There's a breathing that goes on. That's why there weren't any states scheduled for until the 6th of March. That's why they wanted to have that time. You want to see how somebody reacts to adversity and a defeat. And, you know, the racial dimension of it that you address, Barack Obama, I think, won Iowa in 2012, and the last time I checked, the African-American population of 2008 was not the decisive factor in his victory.
Well, it's a victory to have the two of you here every Friday.
Oh,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mark Shields, David Brooks.
Thank you.